thanks to our supporters, the International Union of Radio Science, URSI, and the Engineering in Medicine Biology chapter of the Czechoslovakia section of IEEE. Today, my pleasure to introduce Dr. Salim Hanay from Turkey, from Bilkent University. So, Dr. Hanay, he earned his PhD degree in physics from Caltech in 2011, and these times developed nanomechanical sensors capable of detecting and weighing single protein molecules in the real time. Then he continued his research there as a postdoctoral fellow, and after 2 years, he joined Bilkent University. He currently focuses on research on the detection of viruses and nanoparticles using nanomechanical mass spectrometry, and also on microwave sensing of nanoparticles in microfluidic systems, which is also of great interest of us. He's recipient of several awards from various research organizations, including Turkish Academy of Sciences, IEEE, Turkey section, and also he was awarded the Distinguished Teaching Award of Bilkent University. His research group at Bilkent, he's supported by several national grants and also EU programs such as ERC Starting Grant and Proof of Concept Grants, which is a great, great prestigious honor. And currently he's associate professor at Bilkent University. And right now he's speaking to us also in the capacity as a visiting associate at Caltech. So Selim, please, the video floor is yours. Go ahead.
Thank you very much. I believe now the screen is being shared and you can see it full screen. Thank you again for the invitation to talk in this exciting webinar series. And today, basically, I'm going to talk about the microwave sensors for the analysis of larger scale objects, cells, micro nanoparticles in liquid. Of course, there is, I think, a very significant interest and an expanding field for the microwave and terahertz radiation interactions with the proteins, and especially the hosting institute, I think is like a pioneering place in this field, and it's my honor to be presenting in the webinar organized by the by your institute. So we are located Bilkent University in Ankara, Turkey, and this is basically we are from our campus, and basically one of the expertise areas in our university is micro nanotechnologies, and we have like several clean rooms in the university campus. And indeed, my research interests have been more on the nanotechnology side, nanomechanical systems for sensing and actuators applications. But in recent years, I became more and more interested in the microwave sensing and resonators, especially within the context of microfluidics. Now, basically, why am I getting more and more interested in microwaves? I'll basically explain this a little bit, but let me show you like what we have been doing in our other life, like other research topics. So, for instance, what you see is a video from an scanning electron microscope and buckling of a small mechanical object controlled by electrostatic voltages. So basically, this is the type of machines that we have been working with. But we also do sensing applications with nanomechanical systems. And basically, the real bridge, the connection is between the nanomechanical and microwave domains that we see is on the sensing regions, so sensing applications. So for this reason, I want to maybe spend some 10 minutes or so to talk briefly about the nanomechanical aspect of sensing small particles and viruses. Then I'll make the bridge to the microwave applications and talk about the technologies over here. And also the, I think, language and the framework in the nanomechanical mass spectrometry aspects will also help us some of the parameters for the microwave sensing applications as well. So basically, just by measuring the size or mass of an object gives us a lot of information already, such as the identity of a protein or a molecule for the spectrometric analysis, but also for larger objects, we can have functionality and dynamics, such as antibacteria susceptibility. And basically, when we think about objects from light to heavy, we see that conventional mass spectrometers based on, for instance, quadruple ion traps, time of flight instruments, etc., can measure them very well. And of course, at the larger scale, we have microscopy or impedance cytometry, etc., to detect and size cells and bacteria. But still, within this range, there is the gap for objects such as viruses and nanoparticles, where there aren't much high throughput and high resolution techniques. So this is basically a gap that we think we can fill with both nanomechanical systems as well as microwave sensors. On the nanomechanical side, basically what we are building is a chip technology, a chip with very small feature size that has very small mechanical objects, resonators. And these resonators basically vibrate, such as within this flexural mode, up and down. And of course, there is the resonance frequency, and whenever there is a mass loading effect on the structure, then we have basically the increase in the mass, and then from this increase, the resonance frequency will shift, and we can obtain the frequency and relate this to the mass of the added object. And basically, the scaling factor is the responsivity, so making the structure smaller and smaller obviously gives us larger and larger signals. Framework, we basically work with these small resonators that vibrate up until like 400 or so megahertz, but mechanical vibration, not electromagnetic vibration, oscillation. And by sending protein molecules to this structure, we were able to detect them one by one back in the time. Like this technology faces some challenges, especially for the nanoparticle and virus detection. Now, one challenge is the capture efficiency, because we can build an object, a sensor that has very small dimensions to make this sensitive. As we make it smaller and smaller, the capture cross section will decrease. So it will be very difficult to get particles, virus to this sensor. And second is practicality, because this micro nano devices, they have been housed under vacuum systems. But whenever we have a vacuum system in the laboratory, then we have this like vacuum chambers, vacuum pumps, the cost and the size of the system goes up. So basically, instead of having a chip-based technology, what we have is something like with differential vacuum systems, sometimes cryogenic systems, all integrated into this like large experimental system. So basically, like in recent years, one of our goals in our research group was to make this much more practical by getting rid of the vacuum system, but at the same time, increasing the capture efficiency. And we basically recently achieved a new approach that basically works under entirely atmospheric conditions, ambient conditions, where we have a tip for electrospray ionization, which generates single nanoparticles and viruses under atmospheric conditions, and lensing to roughly send the particles to the NAMS chip, where we have this nanoscale detector. But we also have an insulating layer which acts as an on-chip lens. And as we send these particles, they start collecting and charging up the insulating layer. And it's at one point, the insulating layer will have enough charge accumulated on it that it will start focusing the particles onto the nanomechanical sensor. And with this way, basically, we have the self-focusing NAMS technology where we can focus particles. So for instance, like what you see here is an SEM image where we have the sensitive bridge. And all around you can see these bright dots, and these dots are 40 nanometer gold nanoparticles. And we have basically more or less uniform deposition. By using lensing, now you can see there are much more particles collected on the structure, but just within 5 minutes rather than 3 hours. So you can see we have almost like three times more particles here. And we can actually even look at this closely and see that there is this focusing taking place right on top of our nanomechanical sensor. And basically, with this breakthrough, and we can also see this through the frequency change versus time. So this is the same experiment, but when we look at the data obtained by the nanomechanical sensor, you can see without focusing, we need to do like several hours of running and maybe tens of particles. But with the Lansing solution, we can just apply it for 3 minutes and we can get these particles really quickly. And then we can apply this to different particles, 20, 40, 100 nanometer, etc. We can even do virus detection by basically sending, in this case, the coronavirus and obtaining its mass distribution and converting this to a size distribution by using the density of typical density for viruses, and we get something close to 100 nanometers, which agrees with the other techniques. So this way, we were able to have a tip and chip-based system for nanomechanical sensors and make it much practical, much smaller, and detected, analyzed at a single nanoparticle level, different analyze. Okay, great, excellent. So basically then we have these nanomechanical sensing and actuator technology, but why are we interested in microwaves? The main reason is that microwaves, they act as very efficient sensor technology for liquid sensing, for in-liquid sensing. Because when we put a mechanical structure into liquid, it will dampen, the mechanical motion will dampen and will have low quality factors. There are still some solutions in the mechanical domain, such as having the microfluidic channel pass through the mechanical structure or using the breathing modes and coupling with an optomechanical system to read out the mechanical motion, etc. But these are more involved experimental systems. And in terms of fabrication, I think the microwave resonator path is much, much simpler. So for the microwave sensing part, first I want to draw some parallels between nanomechanical and microwave sensors before going on to different sensing applications. So when we think about nanomechanics, of course, we are thinking about the mechanical displacements. But for microwaves, then we are going to work with mostly electric field distribution. And if we have a suitable microfluidic channel, then the electric field mode shapes distributions will be almost similar to the nanomechanical structures distributions if the boundary conditions are similar. Of course, with NAMs, we are measuring the displacements, and it's a mechanical domain oscillator. With the microwave, we have an RLC model. NAMs is more sensitive to the mass change. On the other hand, when we have the microwave resonator, the particle, when it comes to the sensing region, it will induce a change in the capacitance, assuming that the particle does not have any magnetic properties. And even the equations are the same. So basically, in one case, we have the mass change affecting the frequency change. On the other hand, we have the capacitance change determining the frequency change. And of course, the induced capacitance, it will depend on the volume of the incoming particle as well as its polarizability properties, the permittivity. And of course, this is turns out to be the closest Mossotti factor, where we have basically the permittivity difference at the top, very similar to the difference in the densities, but then a correction term in the denominator coming from the effect of the dipoles. So basically then we can apply many of the techniques and tricks that we have developed in the nanomechanical domain to the microwave domain. And the typical sensors that we are using are one coplanar waveguide resonators, CPW resonators, and we can then put a microfluidic channel, and inside the microfluidic channel, we have basically a small sensing gap to basically detect microparticles and single cells. And similarly, another sensing technology that we are using is the split ring resonator. In this case, we basically built the gap region to have a very small distance to increase basically the electric field around here and to basically accomplish sensing in this region by passing a microfluidic channel through it. And again, this will determine the capacitance. So this is basically some illustration of the structure where we have the resonator and the microfluidic channel passing through this. So basically, to summarize, in both cases, we are working with resonator technologies and they respond to the particle size. And of course, mass density versus the closest Mosotov factor is the main parameters, intrinsic parameters that we are working with. And as I said, we are usually work with CPW or SRR split ring resonator sensors. And with this basically perspective, then we applied the sensing modalities on different applications. So in one case, basically we want to see if we can have the position of different analytes read out by microwave sensors. And the main idea is the following. So when we have a small structure, a cell, a particle, etc., in a microwave resonator, as it passes through the active region, it will induce different frequency chains on different modes. Can we somehow use these different modes and obtain different information? Because when we think about a mode, we can think about it as an independent degree of freedom of the system. And as a result, each measurement in each mode should constitute an independent measurement on the particle's properties. Of course, a part of the properties related to the closest Mosotov factor at that particular frequency, but part of the property that's being measured or probed is the geometrical overlap between the mode shapes and the particle's distribution, the permittivity distribution function, the spatial function as a function of position. And if you can use an imaging algorithm, which basically exists in the literature, we can then obtain not only the electrical volume of the particle, but also other properties such as the location and even an image by basically using large number of modes. And to basically show this in a proof of principle demonstration, we have built a resonator. In this case, it was a microstrip line resonator, so the electric field goes down, and we have basically different channels passing through the below the resonator. And depending, basically, these are the mode shapes, like mode 1 and mode 2 for this resonator. And depending on where the particle passes through the active region, you'll have different signatures, different frequency shifts of the signal. And from these different frequency shifts, we can basically look at the location. In this case, the location is solely determined by the ratio between the second mode to the first mode. And we then conducted this experiment by using a microfluidic system with micro droplets, with the water and oil system. And we have basically the four different channels, A, B, C, D, passing through the microwave resonator. And here you can basically see the droplets passing through the strip line and passing below the strip line. And we were taking data during this time. And this is basically how the data looks like. So like different, like mode 1 and mode 2. And you can see, for instance, for channel D, mode 2 has almost zero frequency change, whereas mode 1 has a large change. This is because for channel D was at the center of this resonator, where mode 2 has a node, so it doesn't really respond to the change at this particular location. And then we can take this data and draw, basically we can place the frequency change in the first mode, frequency change in the second mode, and see if we have the expectation. And indeed, this is basically how the actual data looks like. So we have four channels, and you can see we have four clusters for A, B, C, and D, which basically is expected from the contours for the constant position. So these then come to relate to the different positions on the channel. We also have basically contours for constant size. They also correspond to the same more or less the same size particles. And from here, we can take the projections to the position and to the size plane, and we can basically get the electrical volume of the droplets, more or less giving a uniform distribution, but also the position of the droplets within the channel. So like which channel they pass through, A or B or C or D. So which basically then demonstrates that the mode shape based positioning is possible with microwave resonators as well. And from here then we switch to more cell and microparticle based detection. And here basically we can see one example experiment where we are sending polystyrene particles of different sizes. So these are, I think, 20 microns, sometimes we have 30 and 10 microns, etc. And from the frequency change, then we can also look at, we can not only update the size, but we can also look at in real time how the cells respond to different chemicals. In this case, we applied the MSO to the cells, which basically induces chemical change inside the cellular structure. And as you can see, basically within the 30 minutes of the monitoring of the same cell back and forth, we can see a change and overall decrease, whereas the control experiments do not indicate such change. In this case, the data dispersion is quite large because of the uncertainty in the position, which I'll talk about later on. But one thing that's basically emerged from these experiments was the following. When we look at a polystyrene particle versus a cell particle, and we were looking at the optical image at the same time microwave shifts, right? And it's basically around 10 microns. One thing that's immediately obvious is the difference in terms of the microwave signal. Because of the change, the difference in the permittivity, polystyrene particles will induce a much larger signal in the microwave domain compared to a similar sized cell on the same system. So then this brings out the following idea. Can we do flow through material classification based on dielectric constants? And where it can be important? It can be important for material science, for basically synthetic microparticles, especially composite microparticles, but also the, I think, emerging concern about microplastics. As you know, microplastics are detected more or less everywhere in the environment, in organisms. And like how harmful they are is being still debated. But like one concern is that they have surfaces which can absorb harmful toxic materials from the environment and then bring them to our bodies. And then they, since they don't disintegrate for a long time, then it's a prolonged health concern. And this is based from the same paper which shows the range of microplastics and nanoplastics, which is especially especially threatening because they can pass into the blood-brain barrier, but also into the cells as well. Of course, for like nanoscale objects, our earlier discussion on the atmospheric pressure NAMPS mass spectrometry one could be like one of the, I think, approaches is relevant. But for microplastics, what we want to see is like how we can screen in for the drinking water for the microplastics at high throughputs. Now, there are, of course, at the moment, different tools such as FTIR and micro-Raman spectroscopy, but they are usually expensive and not very high throughput. Indeed, some states and countries, such as California, has started to screen put policies on for screening microplastics. And basically, they have reports that basically show like the practical aspects of Raman and FTIR spectroscopy. And one, I think, important part from these papers is the large amount of time needed for microplastic analysis. Because like per particle, first the particle needs to be detected under optical microscope, and then spectroscopy needs to be taken, which takes almost 20 minutes of time, which needs to be done with a highly qualified scientist. So it's basically quite a labor-intensive effort. So then that's why like we are thinking if we can help with the flow-through classification. coming back to the data, so basically we have been doing this, of course, with optical and microwave, but whenever we have the optical system, it becomes more expensive, more time consuming. Can we do it with an entirely electronic way to basically do the classification for different particles? And coming back to our microwave sensor, as you may remember, the microwave signal was proportional to the volume of the particle and the closest Mosotti factor, right? Because at microwaves, even if you do ionic liquids with ions in it, at like physiological concentrations, microwave is so fast that the ions will not be able to react. So then you will be able to probe inside the material proportion and get the closest Mosotti factor for the material, right? But what happens at low frequencies? And at low frequencies, of course, we have a name for this. This is basically the closest Mosotti factor, as I mentioned before. For low frequencies, we have the Coulter principle and also impedance cytometry in general. In this case, basically, there is a ionic transportation, so ionic current between two electrodes. And when you have a constriction, when we have a constriction, then we have the particle will block this ionic current. And the size of the current, the size of the blockage is proportional to the volume of the particle. It, as long as the particles insulating, it's a dielectric, it will not have any all the intrinsic parameters. Now, if we can combine these two different families on the same sensor, right, then we can divide them and the volume will factor out and we'll directly get the closest Mosotti factor. And if we know the medium parameters, we can basically obtain the permittivity of the material, okay? And then we implemented this idea on a hybrid sensor where we have the split ring resonator plus extra electrodes for impedance cytometry. So in this case, basically we have this low frequency, I think, 500 kilohertz and 5 gigahertz microwave sensing together. And this is how the sensor looks like with the microfluidic channel and different connections. And basically then we can obtain the signal for the Coulter counter with 5 electrodes and the microwave sensing, both in amplitude and the phase, and combine these signals to get the closest Mosotti factor. Now, one technicality, of course, is the, as I mentioned before, location of the particle in the channel, because if the particle passes through the close to the electrodes, it will induce a larger frequency change or current change depending on the sensor. If it goes through the top of the channel, it will induce a smaller change. But this problem was solved, I think, 5-6 years ago by several groups, such as Casali group, also Heibel-Morgan's group. Basically, the solution is to use multiple electrodes, in this case 5 electrodes, and as the particle passes through this sensing region, the particular trajectory, the particular, for instance, the prominence value of these peaks will basically encode the location, the altitude location of the particle in the channel. And from here you can do this calibration, and this is basically what we are doing to calibrate out those signals. And coming back, so basically this is why we are using 5 electrodes in the low frequency part to get the particle height, and then we can calibrate both the microwave sensing and the low frequency sensing from here. And then if you plot microwave and the low frequency signals together, the expectation is that the two different materials will give us different slopes from where we can then obtain the closest Mosotti factors. Now, of course, the first question is, can we differentiate between biologic materials such as cells versus non-biologic materials such as microplastics? Now, the thing is, the biologic materials, they contain a lot of water, and as a result, they have their closest Mosotti factor will be much larger. Well, sorry, I think there is a we should change the order here. But even with like a very quick experiment, you can see the microparticles versus cells, they differentiate from each other. And basically a lot of people have already shown this at low frequencies as well. And it's quite easy to discriminate biologic versus non-biologic particles. But the real challenge is between non-biologic particles, because then you don't have the effect of water anymore to give a boost for the biologic signal. And in this case, for instance, we consider two particles, polystyrene, which is a typical plastic, and soda lime glass. This is basically a glass material which is found in bottles, windows. It's the most common glass material, okay? And the permittivities are 3 and 7, roughly. So great, right? Like almost two times permittivity difference. But the thing is, once we look at the closest Mosotti factors, because of the water's effect, water has a large permittivity, the closest Mosotti factors are actually very close to each other, 0.47 versus 0.43. So almost only like a 10% difference. But earlier, you see like we had like a 500% difference. Now we are trying to resolve a difference of only 10%. So this was basically the main challenge. But with the hybrid system, basically we look at 20 micron particles, and in this case what we are seeing is a polystyrene particle signal. This is the geometric diameter extracted from the low frequency impedance cytometry, spectrometry, and then here on the y-axis we have the microwave signals, which will give us the electrical diameter. And basically, if you look at closely, we almost get 1% dispersion or coefficient of variation in the polystyrene signal, which basically is required because now I'm going to put the soda lime glass signal, which is only 10% difference. And as you can see, they come very close to each other. And we are also extending this line all the way to zero because they should fall on a line passing through the origin. And as you can see, they are close to each other, but if you look at closely, you can see they are still separable with more than 90% separability. And from here, basically, we can just like look at the slope, and you can see that the slopes, from the slopes, although there is some overlap, more or less like particles are producing different opacity values or closest Mosotti factors. And if we basically normalize these signals with respect to the closest Mosotti or polystyrene, the location of the soda lime glass matches where we expect. So it comes close to 0.43. So it's indeed close to 10% difference. And from here, basically then where we can go for instance, environmental screening. Most of the environmental contaminants, other than plastics, they have high permittivity values. For plastics, especially that can be transported by water, they are usually having low permittivity values. So although it's not a perfect classification, it can still help us with increasing the number of in the data set, and also with high reliability, eliminating non-plastic particles from downstream analysis. So it can be basically a intermediate step between collection and the spectroscopy that comes later on. But it basically can eliminate the larger part of the part of the particles with large permittivity, which are definitely not plastics. Now, can we extend this to smaller and smaller particles, and in this case, basically, there's a very nice work by Blick's group, I think 2018, where they use a nanopore and a membrane to detect single molecules. And we basically used our own nanofabrication expertise by using a basic different geometry, different materials. In this case, we use a silicon nitride membrane, which is only 220 nanometer thick, so that we don't have the pore getting clogged by the particle passage. Used electron beam lithography and FIB, focused ion beam, to basically drill a hole on the nanopore, at the same time putting the signal and ground electrodes that comes close like this. So that the electric field is most confined in this region, and when a particle passes through the nanopore, it will induce signals on the microwave resonator. And it's basically like one example signal where you see the control run in blue and the polystyrene run for 100 nanometer particles in orange. And the control run in this case basically is shifted a little bit to see the difference. And you can see within the control run, we are not seeing any spike-like events, but with the polystyrene nanoparticle runs, we are observing these spike-like events passing through the particle, through the nanopore. And then we look at the histogram. The histogram is a little bit polydispersed. There is basically almost an exponential decay rather than a nice Gaussian shape. And we believe that this is because of our design of electrodes. Because of the electrode shapes, we basically try to increase the electric field at the center. But once we do this, of course, the particles that are passing through the sides of the channels will induce a smaller capacitive change on the resonator. That's why we are now working on to engineer this region with our system. But I think like one interesting message is that the microwave sensors on nanomembranes with nanopores can be a very strong sensor technology for nanoparticles and viruses. And by the way, of course, in this case, we have the nanopore plus the nanomembrane, but is it also interesting to look at the nanomembrane by itself? We also look at this, but within a microfluidic system. So you can see the cross-sectional view where we have the PDMS, the micro part of the microwave resonator, and the membrane. Now, in this case, the membrane is only 220 nanometer thick silicon nitride. And it turns out it's quite robust to pressure change. In this case, we are applying 0 bar to 4 bar, like 4 times the atmospheric pressure. And the silicon nitride membrane can still withstand this large variations in the pressure. And the microwave resonator, since we have the capacitive coupling in between, as the silicon nitride membrane deforms, we can read this electronically by the microwave resonators and relate the gas pressure to the change in the microwave frequency. We can also pass liquid through these, and when the liquid passes, I think something quite interesting also happens. So again, what we see here is the silicon nitride membrane and microfluidic channel, but because of the small dimensions, we have these wrinkles on the membrane, and at a constant flow rate, we observe these pulsations, this dynamical instability of the membrane. Now, in this case, it is visible in the optical microscope, but as you can see, we also have the microwave resonator over there, which then can detect the change in the local capacitance. And if we look at these chains in the microwave phase, we can see these pulsations very clearly recorded by the microwave resonator. And as we change the flow rate, we can basically see the pulse intervals changing, so the frequency changes. So the instability frequency versus the flow rate can be deduced by microwave resonance. And what you see is like channels with different dimensions giving rise to different frequencies. So in summary for the microwave part, we basically are in the process of translating our expertise in nanomechanics into microwaves. And one part is basically the use of higher order modes of the microwave resonator to get positional information. Dynamics of single cells, but as well as the classification of different microparticles is possible if we use, if we combine microwave technology with low frequency impedance analysis. The detection of nanoparticles in liquid is possible, and also flow rate sensing by membrane pulsations and instability. With this, I'd like to finish with acknowledging the students and postdoc who contributed significantly to these projects at Bilkent University. And thank you for your time and attention.
Thank you very much.
Much.
Thank you. That was really an excellent talk. Let me first try to ask the audience if there is any questions. So feel free to raise your hand. Otherwise, I have quite some questions. So we'll see how it goes. So before I see any hand, I'll take an opportunity as a organizer to ask first. So I was wondering about the typical quality factors of the resonators, which you, the microwave resonators, which you use. Like, what's the
like 40 to 100, like hundreds.
Like okay, so a few tens, let's say 40 to around 100. I see. So that's typically what you need to distinguish. So, and there, it's like more maybe fundamental question. The quality factor from what data you use to determine the width of the resonance curve? Is it from the S parameters directly, or do you transfer them to other parameters like the impedance parameters?
No. We just like simply use S parameters.
Okay.
But in the measurements, we don't use a network analyzer. We use basically.
Okay.
If I can see it, maybe I can show this. Yes, it's in the liquid, 40 to 100. But I mean, liquid is, of course, is only at the sensing region, right? Like, so you have a little region that's just air and whatever dielectric we have. But like the liquid part is only a small section of the particle. So basically, like, instead of using a network analyzer, what we are using is narrow band detection by using a Luckin amplifier. Of course, Luckin amplifiers, they usually work at low frequencies. I mean, recently, I think Zurich Instrument has one that comes to gigahertz frequencies. So we need to mix down, and basically we use a little the work of the Thompson group to basically build this circuit, but yeah, I mean, the detection circuit, it uses a Luckin amplifier rather than a VNA.
Okay. So I see. Yeah, that's then. Okay, so I wanted to think like what the response means there of the. But yeah, okay, thank you. There are some questions coming in, and let me go to see if I can. So you kind of ask, yeah, it's in the liquid. So let me give a word now to Dashina Kalin. If you see, okay, let me unmute him or her. Make a presenter. So Dashina Kalin, if you like, you can unmute and. Go ahead and ask the question yourself.
Thank you very much for this very interesting talk. I was wondering if you think that we could get any benefit by using millimeter waves or terahertz waves instead of microwaves.
No, definitely. Basically, one benefit that comes to mind is the following. So basically, we use mod shapes, right, to basically get the I'm just trying to open up the slide. Show you. Yes, we use the basically mod shapes to get like location information, right? So at higher frequencies, of course, like the confinement, or the wavelength will be small, and we can get higher and higher resolution. So there is definitely, I think, a little plus, of course. There are other aspects such as like interaction with the matter, like single proteins, for instance. So yeah, there's I think a lot of interest and a lot of potential in going to high frequencies. But one reason we started with this, like the, let's say, 21 to 20 gigahertz range, is the permittivity of the water. It's still large. Right until let's say like the transition region between 5 to 20 gigahertz. So as a result, when a particle passes through the sensing region, it displaces water. And what we are measuring actually is the mostly the displacement of the water rather than the particle's effect itself. So I mean, it gives us a boost to use low gigahertz frequencies in terms of sizing and detection, but it also makes our life difficult in terms of differentiating different particles as well. So there are both like advantages and disadvantages. But yeah, there is definitely, I think, a huge incentive to go to higher and higher frequencies. Let me see if
okay,
I can.
Thank you very much.
It's a good point. We've been also thinking in our lab, like exactly what you mentioned, right? The contrast between the typical, let's say, solid state or biological structures gets lower compared to the water, gets lower when you go to the higher frequency, obviously, because about the dispersion of the basically of the water rotation, it's just, yeah, then that's after 100 gigahertz you'll be already at permittivity of 10 of the water, so then your contrasts are much lower, so and plus also there are higher challenges with achieving higher Q factors, because everything becomes more lossy, even the substrates for a sub terahertz. So it's, for some sensing application, it might be smarter to stay in the gigahertz. Right. But in the case of when I, of course, go closer with the wavelength to the object, it makes sense to go higher frequencies. That there might be that the object gets electrically larger, so it's all the things can be, bring benefits. So it's has to be probably balanced on the particular cases. I see Ashan has a question. So can you see it, Selim, or I can make Ashan?
Yes, yes. Do you incorporate any Fourier transform techniques with Luckin amplifier? Do you mean like different?
So you can ask the question yourself, Ashan.
Different modes or? By using different, or maybe like if you can clarify the question a little bit, I think that will be.
I made Ashan a presenter, so just up to them to unmute and ask if they're still there. So.
Let me see if I can. So I think like what something that comes to mind is the following. To get the spectrum from time.
See. Maybe Ashan cannot. Okay. Can you ask a question if you, Ashan, if you are. Okay, maybe the microphone is not working. Anyway, it was like asking to have more sensitivity for frequency. Oh, I see, he's muted, I see. But you can unmute yourself, you should be.
Okay, of course. So the main thing that we do is, of course, increase the Luckin time constant. Right, like there is a trade-off of making the measurement slower, but then having the signal-to-noise ratio larger. So that's the main thing that we do, but for Fourier transform, so like look at the noise spectrum, for instance, I mean, that can be done, yes. But looking for, for instance, interference, like an interfering signal, like let's say the power line interference, etc. So it's usually, like a boring spectrum, so we don't usually go and check, but probably it may be important in different contexts, especially where there is an interference.
So I was wondering when you mentioned that the speed of the measurement, so it's something I was also seeing, like typically in VNAs it takes some time for sweeping, again depends on the parameters, but for the data which you show, like what is the typical, like how many data points do you get per second, like for some of the examples which you showed?
Right. So, there are two things. Maybe I can go back. So let me see. So first of all, you can operate them in two different modes. Okay. So in one mode, like this is nanopore data with polystyrene. What was the data rate? But I mean, it's like, I think 30,000 samples, like 30K samples per second. So it's like very high data rate. If we just like use the Luckin amplifier and read like whatever is coming back, okay? But in that case, of course, so this is just a sampling rate, but the measurement bandwidth will be determined by the Luckin time constant. And this Luckin time constant, you can basically, with the previous question, that's a good point. Actually, you can check the noise spectrum and pick basically a time scale where you have a reasonably small noise value. So basically, you can then look at the trade-off between making it slow or making it fast, and like where will be the sweet spot. I guess the question is perhaps like related to that. So you can do like 100 microsecond Luckin time constant. I think because like in this case the events were on the order of like tens of milliseconds, so we were using I think at least like 1 millisecond or so time scale. So you can do like very fast. But in this case now, one thing you can see is the phase drifts as a function of time. So there is no Luckin, there is no phase lock loop in this case. But in other experiments, such as these like cell experiments, let me see if I, yes. Now you see like in this particular case, there is a controller. I guess there's not a controller in this case as well. Sorry. Yeah, some of the experiments we have the controller, and the controller basically forces the phase to go back to zero. So the frequency always returns back to the same value. In that case, the CPU and the communication between the CPU and the Luckin amplifier comes into place, and then you can do like I think at most 100 millisecond or so PLL time. So then the measurements are really slow in that case. So if you want to do high throughput microfluidic screening, then phase lock loop is not the way to go. It is like with the existing or like let's say typical systems with like GPIB control, for instance.
Okay. Yeah, that's cool. Because typically microwavers coming from a microwave, that usually does the sensor of the VNA, so they don't even think they could do such a high frame rate, because achieving like 100 kilohertz sampling time of that's something which is not possible with standard VNAs.
Of course, so that's cool. Like, narrow band, of course, like what we
are. Yeah, narrow, obviously. Even there, I think there are some limits in the hardware, typically in the standard VNA. So that's for the purpose you're using it. That's really a great fit. There's one more question from Vikram. I was asking to what are the challenges in fabrications of such NEMS sensors. I made Vikram a presenter, so we can ask yourself or just follow up the question, or send me one answer.
Basically the first, of course, infrastructure. You need like electron beam lithography, for instance, and plasma etchers. Second, know-how. Usually you need to learn this from someone like experienced in this field. These are the, I think, main challenges. But of course, like you can like always collaborate with other groups who do the nanofabrication, and we are open to collaborations for different projects, for instance. These are the main challenges, I think.
Okay, and maybe follow up from my side. So, what about the sample prep? And these like tricks with the hydrophobicity, the device preparation, like there's always like that's one thing, it's fabricated stuff, then to make it used with particle sample, like what will be like, what are the main challenges, for example, for the microparticles you've been testing for?
Mostly I think the standard soft lithography is being used, and we also use some surfactants on the like very small amount to basically eliminate the aggregation and clogging things. But it's usually a problem. We basically like recently used a different technology, entirely deformable microfluidics, where you can change the channel size to basically it is like help with some of the biological problems, but I think these are the main issues.
I see. Okay, cool. So, I had something on my mind, but I slipped out of my mind what I wanted to ask. So, let's see if there are any more questions. And for the nanopore measurements, I think the challenge for anybody who is doing these kind of measurements, the clogging, right? That's
Yeah.
So there's be some pre-filtering, I guess.
Yes, definitely. Like usually, after some time, like I think in our case, several hours, you simply don't see any events, and then take it to the SCM. There is usually some junk being deposited over there. Yeah, so I think it's really the cloaking. So one thing I think microwave is interesting is the following. So usually, not, of course, like when we think about nanopore, the like larger community uses resistive pulse sensing, similar to the Kalto counters, right? So basically, the nanopore gets blocked partially by the passing particle. So the particle size should match the nanopore size closely. But with microwaves, like we don't have that limitation as strict. Plus, like we can, I think it can be easier for microwave sensors to multiplex these nanopores because we are not like limited by the again the blockage current, but we can have like multiple sensing regions. Of course, like each sensing region will decrease the efficiency, but it won't decrease as much as the case for nanopore with the resistive pulse sensing. Where you need like a tight matching.
I see. In the case like well, microwaves, then if you would be like integrating the, let's say, many sensing spots, there might be a challenge for some cross coupling, maybe, like, you know, it's because it's I mean, capacitive coupling between the that's something which can be challenges, I think, for higher frequencies, isn't it?
No, definitely. Also, like particles that are coming close to the surface but not passing through the through the nanopore. We will, most likely part of the tail is coming from there as well. But yeah, we'll have to do more experiments to see this, like, for sure.
I see. And I'm curious if you have any ongoing projects or thoughts on with, let's say, of these microwave resonators and or microwave sensors and the proteins, because you showed in the beginning like what you did for your PhD, things on the and.
Yeah, I think that's the dream. Yeah, we have some ideas to do it, but I don't know if, like, how feasible they are. Maybe we can talk, or like anybody interested, and we can I think about these. I think it's like the time is really ripe to think about like these single protein sensing with microwave or terahertz radiation. I think it's a very exciting frontier at the moment.
Yes, absolutely.
But no, we don't have an ongoing project. I think something is in the air, but not like very concrete. I think, like, especially on our side. Yeah.
That'll be definitely a frontier. So, with the microwave sensing, what do you think is by our state of knowledge, is the lowest particle detected so far? Obviously, if you go for a high contrast particles like metal ones, probably it's easier.
Right.
But what's the state of the art for by your knowledge?
We also look at. I think Blick Group has a 2018 PRL paper where they show like single molecules passing through a similar nanopore with microwave.
That's what you mentioned. I have to check out that paper.
Several events that show this, like, shows the passage of the things. I think it can be an interesting paper to look at.
I have to see.
Like a tank circuit based something.
Okay. So that's definitely really interesting. Cool. Great. So we spend 1 hour of a really interesting talk and discussion. So let me see if there is any other raised hand. So if it's maybe last call for questions before we conclude the recording part. As I mentioned, again, those who come later, the talk is recorded, but will be only published after I get a green light from Celine. So you have to be patient with the recording then. So I see there are thanks coming in. So if there are no more raised hands for questions, Salim, I would like to sincerely thank you for being ready. So 7 a.m. California time for a talk. Now it's 8, I guess. So thank you very much, and we'll keep in touch. And if you are coming over to regions around, please let me know, and it will be great to host you here. So with that, I would like to also thank to all our attendees, and we should have another webinar in 1 month also on a microwave sensor. So we'll keep you posted. And those who are not in our group, MLN group, please feel free to sign up. Okay. Thank you again, Salim.
Thank you,
I'm finishing the recording now. So stop recording.